I'm State Representative Henry Yanez. Welcome to The State of Your State, my public affairs show that brings the people of Macomb County news about our state capital. Michigan's senior citizens deserve to live comfortably in their retirement because of their hard work, from raising families to working in our offices, business, and schools, has helped build Michigan's economy to make our state great. The state government offers a number of programs for seniors to assist them with their needs and to protect them from those who seek to victimize them. My guest today is Jim McGuire, Director of Research, Policy Development, and Advocacy with the Area Agency on Aging 1B, which serves Macomb County, Southfield, Livingston, Oakland, St. Clair, Monroe, and Washtenaw counties. We will be discussing services available to our senior citizens. Welcome to the show, Jim.
Good morning. Thank you for the invitation.
Jim, can you explain to our viewers what the Area Agency on Aging 1B is and what exactly do you do?
Sure. Our mission is to enhance the lives of older adults and adults with disability. And from there, essentially what we do is we receive the state and federal funds that are allocated to support home and community-based services for older adults. We use those dollars, we don't provide services to older adults directly ourselves, but what we do is we use those dollars to fund programs and services throughout Macomb and our other counties that help frail older adults remain living independently as long as possible. So we're the funder of programs like Meals on Wheels, and most of our dollars go to support in-home services that help physically frail older adults stay in their homes and give them an option to assisted living or nursing home care.
So can you tell, you mentioned Meals on Wheels, can you break down give me an example of some of the other programs that you have and what those programs do? I imagine some of these are tailored for individual seniors who have special needs.
Yeah, exactly. And for the physically frail, we fund services like personal care, help with bathing, assist with people who have trouble performing normal activities of daily living but still want to stay in their own home with a little bit of help. We fund housekeeping. We fund chore services through organizations like Macomb County Community Services Agency, lawn cutting and snow removal for those who can't afford to purchase those services at private market rates but need that work done to stay safely in their home. We fund respite for family caregivers because we know that most frail older adults have family members involved in their care. And what we do with our services is help those caregivers, you know, fill in the gaps and respite to give them a break a little bit at a period of time so that, because the best thing you can do for a family caregiver is, especially someone who's doing care full-time 24/7 to a spouse or parents, is to give them a little break so that they can recharge their batteries and continue being a good caregiver. So the in-home services are our priority, but we also fund other supports like specialized services for visually impaired and hearing impaired services, and access services like outreach to help people know what resources and benefits are available to them and help people sign up for programs.
And is there an age limit on the people that can access your programs?
Well, for our general programs, the age is 60 and older. We do provide a service for Medicaid that serves younger disabled individuals, but generally our services like that people know, like Meals on Wheels and home services, age 60 and above.
And what about an individual's income? How does that come into play when you're looking at providing services to a senior?
Most of our programs, we don't look at income as an eligibility determination. The only exception is for our Medicaid programs like the My Choice Medicaid waiver, which helps low-income seniors who need a nursing home level of care to receive home and community-based services as an alternative. But all of our others are just age 60 plus. And one of the biggest things we do is we have an information and assistance program where people can call our call center, and we have specialists on it that know all the resources. We've got a database of 2,000 services that we can link people to, whether it's looking for housing, assisted living, Meals on Wheels. Anybody can call us, and every call is answered live by a professional.
You had mentioned about providing services in home. Mm-hmm. One of the movements that we've had in this state is to help people stay in their home as opposed to go into a nursing facility. Mm-hmm. A lot of seniors have lived in a home for a very long time. They've paid that home off. The only thing they have to pay is utilities and taxes. And now they've gotten to a point where they may have to have extra care. And in the past, we've always looked at getting into a skilled nursing facility, which could be very costly mm-hmm. for a lot of seniors. So what specific programs are there to help seniors stay in their homes?
Well, the biggest program for the low-income seniors who would depend on the state Medicaid program to pay for nursing home care if they can't afford that care, it's called My Choice. And to be eligible for it, all you need to do is to be eligible based on your physical condition for a nursing home level of care. And what we do is we use those Medicaid nursing home dollars to pay for in-home aides primarily, to provide the bathing assistance, the housekeeping assistance, medication reminders. A lot of the people on the program have those alert buttons, you know, help, I've fallen and I can't get up, mm-hmm. so that if they're alone, they still have some measure of safety.
Sure.
And it's a beautiful program because the costs for the program are a lot less than what the state would pay for nursing home care. We can serve almost three people in the home for what the cost would be for the average person to be in a Medicaid nursing home facility.
And when it comes to, I know we talked a little bit about income here, but what about veterans, people who have served our country? They may or may not be getting VA benefits. Is that something you look at, and are there any special programs for people who are veterans?
There are, especially people with physically frail and who qualify. Veterans are complicated because depending on your status as a veteran, active duty or non-wartime, there may be different eligibility criteria. One of the first things we do when someone calls us for help is we ask them if they might be eligible for Veterans Program, and we will let them know what they might qualify for. The Veterans facility has moved more toward not putting people into their nursing facility, but trying to provide care at home, and they've actually contracted with us where they're using our service delivery system, because we've been doing this since the 70s,
sure.
help people stay at home, to use our service system to serve some of the veterans at home.
Well, that's great, because we know that there's a lot of special needs that many of our veterans have above the normal senior population. So,
mm-hmm.
So if I'm someone who has a senior parent or a senior neighbor and I think that they need help, what kind of information when I call at your office do I need to provide?
Well, some people call looking for something specifically, like, say, an affordable assisted living facility, and we talk to them about what's in their area, where they want to be, and so forth. Others aren't quite sure what they need, and so we do some, you know, probing questions, because we know what typically challenges people are facing. And our goal is to let people know what their options are. We don't push someone to a nursing home or home and community-based services. We just try to tell people what resources are available, what benefits they might qualify if they can't afford services, and then help them contact the organizations that are ultimately going to help them solve problems. And we look at it this way: aging presents a lot of challenges. Aging is very complicated these days. It's not like it used to be where, like, you'd get your Medicare card and you're all set. Now if you get your Medicare card, are you going to do classic fee-for-service Medicare? Are you going to sign up for a Medicare Advantage plan? You got your prescription drug benefit. There are 40 options that seniors can choose from. So it really requires becoming an educated and vigilant advocate, and our job, our role is to help people understand what their options are, explain it to them so that they make the best decisions to solve the challenges they're facing.
So Medicare and Medicaid really have an impact on what kind of services people get. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a little bit about what's going on with Medicare and Medicaid? Can you get both Medicare and Medicaid, same individual? Is that a possibility? So what are some of the, how do we go about doing that?
Well, first of all, you go to Medicare to become eligible for the program, to sign up for the program, once you're age 65 or if you have a permanent disability. But once you're on Medicare, you got two choices. You got the regular fee-for-service Medicare, which allows you to go whichever doctor accepts the bill of the Medicare payment, and then they provide the care and bill Medicare. Or you've got Medicare Advantage, which is like a health maintenance organization, an HMO model. And those are becoming popular primarily because they get a lump sum, and what they do is they tend to provide a little bit higher little benefits, and a lot of the Medicare Advantage plans are lower premiums. So especially if you're struggling to pay that Medicare premium, that's an option that a lot of seniors look at. They cover all the services that Medicaid cover and a little bit more. So that's the first decision you have to make. And I would say roughly about 30% of seniors in your district probably have enrolled in a Medicare Advantage plan. They've kind of grown a little bit each year as they become more popular. And now it's open enrollment November, December, where you see a lot of advertisements on commercials for these plans.
Can you tell me a little bit about Medicare and the Affordable Care Act, how that has impacted the choices that people make when they during these open enrollment periods? Has it made an impact at all?
Medicare, the Affordable Care Act really hasn't affected Medicare and Medicaid too much. They've done some tinkering with benefits and some of the payments to physicians and providers. But from the seniors' perspective, there hasn't been a significant change. They still have both options. They still have open enrollment periods, and they're providing the support for those programs.
So I'm going to ask you this, and when we get to the end of the show, but I'd like to touch it very briefly now about contacting your office. It seems like there's a lot of programs, and people can be overwhelmed, especially when you get to a certain point where you're dealing with a senior parent or a senior relative, and they have a lot of needs. And there's a lot of programs to pick. So exactly how do we get a hold of the Area Agency on Aging?
Well, there's two ways, especially this time of year when people are making decisions about Medicare and their prescription drug plans. You can call us, and we can talk to you about your options. We have one of our programs as a volunteer program called the Medicare Medicaid Assistance Program. It's actually a statewide program run by Area Agencies on Aging throughout the state. What we do is we have about 100 trained volunteers that know all the ins and outs of health insurances, Medicare, Medicaid, and they're available to counsel people by phone over what their options are, do problem solving, help people with appeals if you've been denied benefits. And we also, this time of year, we go out into the communities to sit down with people that want to make appointments. For example, we have a couple of appointments coming up in late November and December at the Sterling Heights Senior Center. The dates, I think, will come up on the screen. They are November 18th and December 2nd, where we'll be there from 10 to 3. We'll have tons of volunteers with laptops, and appointments can be made through our phone number by calling 800-852-7795 if a senior wants to make an appointment, sit down with either a trained volunteer or who are supported by our staff, answer all the questions you have. One of the unique things with, say, choosing a drug plan is there's 40 options. Medicare's got this great program where you go online to the Medicare website and you put in your prescription drugs and a little bit of identifying information, and it'll tell and your prescriptions, and it tells you for those 40 drug plans available in Michigan how much every plan will cost you between its copays, out of pocket, and the cost of the drugs for the next year. So if you're looking for the cheap, if you got a stable set of drugs and you really want the cheapest plan, it'll tell you what the cheapest plan is. It'll tell you how much the Blue Cross, the AARP options, and so forth are. Again, providing information to help people make the best decisions. Not cheapest plan may not always be the best option for you, but we give you the information and let people decide.
That's a lot of information, and you're a fantastic resource. It's kind of a one-stop shopping, wouldn't you say, for someone with at least who has initially getting into asking questions about what to do with their loved one?
Right. For Medicare and Medicaid, sometimes we are the place to start. If we're not, like if you've got detailed veterans questions, we'll send people to the right place so that you just got one more call and one more stop to make.
And can you tell me a little bit about working with other agencies and or working with the local governments, working with Macomb County, City of Sterling Heights, City of Warren? How do they contact you on an occasional basis, or do they have services that interconnect with the Area Agency on Aging?
Well, as I said at the beginning, we don't provide many direct services ourselves. Like when we talked about in-home care, personal care, homemaking, chore, we don't go into the homes providing those services. We select organizations in the county that are the providers of services. So we have contracts with Macomb County government, the Macomb County Community Services Agency, to do things like the CHORE program. The Meals on Wheels in Macomb County are provided by Macomb County Community Services. We provide them the dollars, and they provide the services directly. Same thing with outreach and helping people advocate for services. We fund adult daycare programs in the county through Catholic Services of Macomb.
Oh, that's fantastic.
I think they changed their name. I apologize.
Yeah, that's okay. And adult day services is something that's, I think, probably relatively new. And I think I want to talk a little bit more about that. But right now, we're going to take a quick break. My guest today is Jim McGuire with the Area Agency on Aging, 1B. And we'll be right back for the second half of the show.
NFC, AFC, offensive linemen, defensive tackles, quarterbacks, and cornerbacks are all living united to ensure the academic success of millions of kids in our communities all the way to graduation day. But that won't happen without you. So take the pledge at unitedway.org. Make a difference in the life of a child. Suit up like your favorite NFL players and become a volunteer reader, tutor, or mentor with United Way.
Thank you for joining us on the second half of the State of Your State. My guest today is Jim McGuire, Director of Research, Policy Development, and Advocacy for the Area Agency on Aging 1B, serving Macomb County and other communities. So Jim, you know, tell us a little bit about the senior population. I understand there's more of us, you know, as a late end-stage baby boomer. I guess I'm getting pretty close to that. Can you tell us a little bit more about the senior population? I understand there's something they call the silver tsunami. What is that
sure.
all about?
Well, what that does is that refers to this phenomena of the baby boom generation becoming of age and becoming seniors. And to look at it from the numbers, I'm a little bit of a junior demographer, between 2000 and 2030 in your district, the number of seniors age 60 and above is going to double. And I think a lot of people, like if you've been to Florida and you know how omnipresent the senior population is there, Sterling Heights is going to look like Florida does today in about 5 years in terms of the presence of seniors. Eventually by 2030, it should get to around 1 in 4 Sterling Heights residents and Warren residents being age 60 and older. So that's the phenomena, the silver tsunami. And the question is, how well are we prepared as a society and as communities to deal with that population? I think that the natural reaction is to say, oh my gosh, all these seniors, how can we afford this? You know, the demand on public resources is always a concern. But there is a very interesting study done by a guy named David Densford, an economist out of South Florida, who assessed the impact of the senior population growth on state and local governments. And what he found was for every $3 in public resources that the senior population consumes, they're actually paying back $4 in public benefits through taxes. The senior population is really a net boom economically to our communities. And the reason, if I can explain
Please
this,
do.
is when you look at a senior income, in Macomb County, the average 65-plus household's income is about $37,000 a year. So the average senior has the resources to pay to be a net contributor. And in many ways, that having a senior in your community is as good or better than having a new job in the community, because that $37,000 in the average senior household, that's money that's imported into Macomb County's economy because it comes from outside in the form of Social Security, pension income, or earnings on investment. Again, it's money that comes from outside the county into the county, bolstering the economy. Most jobs typically move money around in the economy, which is not as great of a net benefit. So that's why we're kind of embracing the growth of the population. It's also stable resources because the economy goes down, Social Security checks continue to come in. And that's why a lot of communities are looking at becoming much more age-friendly and welcoming and retirement destinations of choice for the social benefits as well as the economic benefits.
So kind of dovetailing off of that, we're probably looking at some stresses on our infrastructure. I know as a retired firefighter, a lot of our 911 calls were to senior homes, and as the senior population grows, what are some of the other stresses that we're going to see within our governmental infrastructure? I know transportation is one of those issues. Can you talk a little bit about transportation, the senior population?
Sure, and so the needs of an older population become more present in the community than, say, the needs of the younger population. And by example, now in Sterling Heights and in Warren, there are more seniors than there are school-age children. So you look at how many schools do we have and how many seniors do we have in those communities, and do we have the right balance? And when you talk about EMS services and so forth, that's where some of the demands will increase related to the population. And in transportation, about 80% of seniors have their own car and have transportation, but it's that 20%, and really it's about 13% would say in our surveys they have difficulty getting to places they need to go. That's the population that's the target for and needs services like SMART or the door-to-door services available through the Senior Center in Sterling Heights and through the Community Center in Warren. And those are very challenging programs. They haven't seen a lot of growth in their funding and their ability to expand capacity. The roads issue is a big issue, but when you look at the roads issue and the $1.2 billion that the governor is trying to, you know, figure out a way to increase, it's questionable whether or not any of those dollars will also go to public transportation. And for seniors, the biggest transportation problem is getting across county and across municipal boundaries, because the local senior service transportation services have very limited geographic areas. So getting to you know, if you're, you know, Beaumont's now coming into the district, if you want to need to get, if you can't go to Troy Beaumont or you need to get to Royal Oak Beaumont, good luck in getting there. That's the challenge.
Yeah.
We do have a resource now that's popped up that we developed to at the Area Agency on Aging to help people with these trips that your local provider can't necessarily provide you a simple solution to. It's called My Ride 2. It's funded by the federal government as a demonstration. And in that, we know all the resources, public, private, taxi, transportation companies, and we do a lot of counseling with people to make these difficult trips, like from Sterling Heights down to the John Dingell Veterans Center, mm-hmm. for example. We know if there are volunteer resources that are available to help with that, or if you're going to look pay for services, what are your options, what would the cost be? So that's a big challenge, and again, the My Ride 2 is another program that can be reached. We have a call center people that answer the phone live every day, and they can be reached through our 800 number, which is the 800-852-7795.
Okay, and so this is one of many challenges, and as the senior population grows, and you help to provide or direct those populations to that population to certain services, your agency must be dealing with a lot of different challenges as this population expands. Can you talk to us about some of the challenges that you face trying to build or maintain this organization?
Well, the biggest challenge is when physically frail, when people grow older, and most of the problems that beset the elderly are related to chronic conditions, things like arthritis, chronic heart failure, diabetes and so forth, that generally limit your ability. And as the chronic conditions worsen, they limit your ability to perform normal activities of daily living, meal preparation, bathing, housekeeping, and so forth. And so that's what our emphasis on in-home services are. The problem is the demand is so great and the cost to purchase those services from home care companies and other resources, you know, average $20-$22 an hour, for people in the low and lower middle incomes and lower incomes can't afford that. And that's generally when they turn to us. We get about 60,000 calls from across our six county region to the Area Agency on Aging looking for information about resources. And for our in-home services, unfortunately, we have wait lists for those. The people that request and need the help and eligible for it are more than we have the public dollars to subsidize the care, even though seniors actually contribute toward the cost of that care based on their ability. That's why, you know, notice you have your silver key.
That shows
that you're a supporter of the goal of the Silver Key Coalition. And the legislature has been very supportive of this goal of trying to make Michigan a no wait list state for in-home services. And it's going to take some additional public dollars to do that. Unfortunately, with the pressures on the state budget, this year the legislature hasn't been able to help us achieve that goal of making Michigan a no wait list state. But today, we've probably got about 4,000 seniors in Michigan on the wait list for programs like home delivered meals, Meals on Wheels. We probably have, I'm guessing, I haven't seen the data lately, we probably have close to 100 seniors waiting for in-home service who contacted us. We think they're eligible, need help, can't afford to buy it, pay for services. Their family caregivers are struggling to get by and meet their elders' needs and need a break and need some help. And we're trying to garner the resources and help that population.
And I've had the opportunity to help with Meals on Wheels. A lot of these programs really rely on volunteers, is that correct?
Yes. Absolutely, because if a volunteer can do that delivery, many of the volunteers do it no charge. Some of them get a little bit of mileage through the Macomb County Community Services Agency. That helps those dollars that are allocated to the agency go further and provide more meals. And in Macomb County, the legislature has been great, thank you very much, about supporting Meals on Wheels. That's a program that people understand, and food is so important. So we barely have wait lists or rarely have wait lists for the Meals on Wheels programs in Macomb County, and we do. They're generally temporary, and they get to people within a reasonable amount of time. It's the other in-home services, the bathing assistance, mm-hmm. the dressing assistance for the real physically frail people who need help day to day, that are where the wait lists are predominantly in Macomb County.
And I found it interesting that a lot of the volunteers are younger seniors helping out older seniors, because they have the time and the resources to do the job,
mm-hmm.
and they're a great resource. So.
Oh yeah, and that program, you know, being a first responder, in many ways those volunteers are first responders, because it's not uncommon for them to, you know, drop a meal off, knock on the door, hear nothing but a faint, you know, help, someone's fallen, can't get up, And they act like a first responder in terms of contacting someone, contacting the family members, emergency contacts to get help, to either literally saving lives sometimes, or getting them to medical treatment so that their medical condition doesn't get exacerbated.
Yeah. So we talked a lot about helping senior populations with medical needs, but what about other things outside the medical assistance? Do you provide any classes or any other kind of support?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. In prevention, you know, most of our services deal with problems, but prevention is a big focus. In fact, we've got a tremendous grant-funded project that's working throughout the state, where the Michigan Health Endowment Fund has funded area agencies to try to prevent falls among seniors and try to help people with diabetes better manage their diabetes so that they don't have the health care problems that you would expect. And so we've got classes going on at senior centers, community centers, health provider locations throughout Macomb County right now. And the classes will be no cost to seniors. They pay a $15 registration fee, but if they complete the class, you get that back in a gift certificate. So for anybody that's, you know, concerned about their balance and their and has a worry about falls, these are the classes that teach you how to address that. It's called, and these are evidence-based programs. We know that they work. We know that when people go through them, they have a less likelihood of falling, which saves, you know, Medicaid dollars, public dollars, insurance dollars, and so forth. Same thing with diabetes. We help people better manage their care, give them lots of information and ideas to change a little bit of their lifestyle so that they can not be beset by the problems of these conditions. All you got to do is call the Area Agency on Aging. We will talk to you about classes that are starting up in your communities, and they're likely to be at your local senior center in Warren Community Center, Sterling Heights Senior Center.
So that's a great way to end this segment in the show is, once again, give us the information how to get in contact with the Area Agency on Aging.
Again, the best way is to call us at the Area Agency on Aging number. We've got a call center. The number is 800-852-7795. We've got about a half a dozen people trained in all the ins and outs of services. We get about 60,000 calls. Every call is answered live. This is not a menu. It's our busy season in November, December, because we're getting a lot of Medicare calls because of open enrollment. I think our average wait time on the phone is about 90 seconds before one of our staff picks up. And if we're having a really bad day, you can always leave a message and we'll have somebody call you back as soon as things break.
Yeah, bad, well, busy is not necessarily bad.
A busy day.
Jim McGuire, I cannot thank you enough for coming out today. You know, seniors are a very important part of our state and certainly my constituency, and I really appreciate all the work that you and your fellow workers over at the Area Agency on Aging do on behalf of our senior population. So thank you very much for coming and giving us this information.
Well, thank you. As a legislator that provides us support that helps seniors, we are grateful to your support as well.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for watching this episode of The State of Your State. I'd like to thank my guest, Jim McGuire, Director of Research, Policy Development, and Advocacy for the Area Agency on Aging 1B. And I'd like to thank all of you for watching. I look forward to another discussion soon about a topic that affects the quality of life here in our community and throughout the state. I encourage you to contact me if you have any questions or concerns, or if I can be of any help. You can contact me toll-free at 1-855-926-3925 by email at henryyanez, that's all one word, at house.mi.gov, and through my website at yanez.housedems.com. That's all one word, yanez.housedems.com. It continues to be an honor to serve you as your voice in Lansing, and I look forward to talking to you again soon. Until then, goodbye.